I meant this video as freestanding, not part of my new course on irony. It's something I've meant to create for a while. I was ambivalent about dropping it now. I should be getting to the new course. See, I rarely suffer writer's block, but I do get writer's muddle, ambivalent about what to get to next. Too many hot leads to follow. Earlier this week, I alternated between working on this and the course, and then I ended up getting into the flow on this one. My ambivalence resolved, I went with it. Only after knocking it into acceptable shape did I realize that though it might be heavy going, it fits in the new series on irony, in which I argue that irony is the realistic, naturalistic, healthy, adaptive response to life's paradoxes, ambiguities, and ambivalences. Writing this, I realized that the free will debate expresses the two more comforting and unrealistic alternatives to irony. Determinism suggests surrendering into absolutely cynical, fatalistic, nihilistic passivity. Free will suggests committing to absolute self-determination. Now, whenever you pair two opposite absolute positions like those, you can wring some irony out of the tension between them. For example, Alan Watts' limerick, "There was a young man who said, damn, for it certainly seems that I am a creature that moves in immutable grooves. I'm not even a bus, I'm a tram." Or Kurt Vonnegut's, "We do doodly do what we must, muddly do until we bust, bodily bust." Or my limerick, "We imagine a tinker named God. Poor old Duff was a bit of a clod. So lacking in skill, he gave us free will. We ask his forgiveness. It's odd." But mostly free will and determinism try to drown out irony. La la la, I can't hear you. Whereas I'm here to promote it. So here's some pretty deep background on irony. In later vids, I'll show how all of this relates to irony lived and breathed and practiced in everyday life. Here goes. Free will versus determinism. The debate goes on. And why? Because no one gets around to explaining what will really is. Willpower, the will to live, the actual physical work we living beings do to keep being the beings we are. The debate is framed badly from the get-go in ways that make it fun for people who like an intellectual catfight, for brawling's sake, without the risk of ever being proven wrong. It's worked well for that. Free will versus determinism fads coming and going. On the determinist side, there are the materialists who assume that nature is just micro stuff, atoms and molecules, whose interactions are as predictable as billiard balls. If that's all there is, then there's no such thing as will, and you are not you. So choose determinism. Convince yourself that you're not a self. You can try to believe that you try and believe, but you don't. You're just a lot of atoms in micromotion. You're a figment of your own imagination. On the free will side, there's the sense that there's got to be more to life than micromatter and micromotion, a thing called will, human consciousness. And the way to prove its existence is to prove that a human can do something free of any external provocation. You know, an uncaused effect, a prime mover. Only that would prove that you have will. Both approaches and all the subtle variations in between sidestep the fundamental question that sidestepped across the sciences. There's a difference between cause and effect physical work and living means to ends willpower or effort. Science should be able to explain how willpower emerged from physical power. The difference between physical work and living effort is obvious. Physical work is there from the beginning of the universe. A rock falls onto a rock and cracks it. No will involved. Will emerges at the beginning of life, first and foremost as a being's struggle for existence. The will to live, which isn't some passive, sure, I'm willing, it's willpower. There's the power of volcanoes and other non-living physical forces that aren't trying to do anything. And then there's the kind of physical power we call effort, trying, striving, struggling, in a word, will. If you really want to understand the will you've got, start by explaining how willed effort emerges from non-willed physical work. explain it from its very origins with no gaps, no hand waves, no smoke and mirrors, no and then a miracle happened, and no assumed fudge factors or forces. You know how religion and spirituality just declare fudge factors? For example, claiming you have some supernatural thingy inside you, a soul or spirit, some magical active ingredient that does the willing. Well, turns out scientists and philosophers do that too. They say you have motivations. Well, what is a motivation? It's just assumed. It's an unexplained explanation. If you see someone make an effort, just assume they have some motivation gizmo in their body that causes it. Say that hormone chemicals trigger motivations, the appetite or will to do something, without ever explaining what motivations are. Such fudge factors are substitutes for explanations. Whether you give your fudge factors soft poetic names like spirit or scientific academic names like motivation, they remain unexplained explanations. Naming is not explaining. Assuming imaginary gizmos is fine for everyday description, you can say your refrigerator has a cooling gizmo in it. That's all you need to know. But if you want to understand what kind of will you've got, you can't just go around naming imaginable gizmos. You have to explain how your willpower, your focused physical work, emerged from non-willed physical work. Our question then, how does will emerge from non-will? We have to start with what life is up against, what scientists agree is the most reliable and universal phenomena in the whole universe, the second law of thermodynamics. Basically, mix-up happens. Order gets disordered. Regularities get irregular. Stuff breaks down. Working order ends up out of order. That's what we're up against in our struggle for existence. The tendency for everything everywhere to break down and stop working. Ain't that a kick in the head? Here we are trying to keep ourselves humming along in reliable working order in a universe bent toward breakdown. Our struggle for existence is an uphill battle against the universal tendency for things to fall out of existence, especially fragile beings like us. Rocks break down too, but super slowly because they're durable. We might wish we were durable like that, for example, when we take comfort in the thought that our soul gizmos will exist for all eternity, but that is not our fate. And the second law is why. I'm so damn fragile that when I die, when my willpower fails, I'll be unrecoverable in minutes. But cheer up. We're not dead yet. And anyway, for all our fragility, here we are still, an uninterrupted chain of living beings that has lasted 3.8 billion years. Impressive, given how fragile we are. And double cheer up, because I've got an explanation for how we pull off our uphill struggle against the generation. A strictly physical, no gaps or gizmos explanation for how your struggle for existence ever got started and sustained itself in working order despite the relentless universal tendency for working order to become disordered. It's based on the work of Berkeley biologist Terrence Deacon, with whom I've studied and collaborated closely for nearly 3 decades. This is my interpretation, but his theory. Bottom line first, explanation after, and then only a first pass. I have other videos, and Terry and I have books and articles that explain it in far more detail. Bottom line, do we have free will, like totally free to do whatever, independent of all outside influences? No, we're not omnipotent. Are we therefore determined like a passive ragdoll tossed about by outside influences? No, we're not impotent. We're somnipotent. You have some willpower by which you try to alter what happens to and through you. But no, you're not free. Life is iffy guesswork and was from the get-go. Before getting into how, what's it like to think of yourself as somnipotent? Is it reassuring or disappointing? Maybe you've been holding out for absolutely free will, omnipotence, the ability to do whatever, whenever, uninfluenced by anything but your own impulses, no constraints, like if you were God ruling the universe or a superhero with infinite superpowers. Every decade or so, you get some can-do movement that says we create our own reality. It's a recurring fad that crests and falls like 17-year locusts. But I get it. Omnipotence sounds fun. Still, I bet you're of two minds about it. You're ambivalent. With freedom comes responsibility, not just to others, but for our own failures. Existential angst, the free willies. Besides, though you want your freedom, you also want a reliable world as your playground. You go to a lot of trouble to stabilize your circumstances. You want freedom without the risk of freefall. You don't want your body doing unreliable, impulsive things, and you like your hopes and your expectations consistently and reliably met. Sure, you don't want to be straitjacketed, confined under a low ceiling, but you don't want the floor falling out from under you either. And what you want, stabilized, can change. You wanted a steady groove, but it became a rut. The poet said he married her to keep her from getting away. Now she's there all day. Or one of my other limericks, this one about what I call ambigamy. In this pairing, I find that I'm fearing about when we'll start breaking and tearing. Oh, don't you dear leave me too soon. It would grieve me. Or too late when you start to get wearing. I bet what you'd really like is a modifiable ratchet. Freedom to rise, determinism to keep you from falling. Freedom to do what you want and safety while doing it. Again, not that what you want matters to what you have. Still, our research suggests that changeable, fallible ratchets are what we get. Okay, and now explanation for the will you've got. Start with the second law of thermodynamics. Breakdown happens. It's really the first law of everything. Toss a box of aligned toothpicks into the ocean and alignment disappears. Why? Because unaligned states outnumber aligned states. Since everything moves around, everything tends to fall into and drift among unaligned or disordered states. That's the number one environmental challenge that willpower would be up against anywhere in the universe. For us to keep working, we need to stay in working order, and no matter where we are working, our order will tend to become disordered and stop working. For the living, existence is not a given. We have to struggle for it, ongoing effort to keep going on. That's the heart of willpower, living beings asserting themselves against the second law tendency to fall out of order. Willpower's priority isn't making babies, self-replicating like durable rubber stamps. It's self-repair, which we do nonstop, chronic self-healing, not just healing the occasional skin knee, but for example, you generating 330 billion replacement cells every day to make up for that many cells breaking down. Okay, asks the free will advocate, but do we do this of our own free will, totally unprovoked, like an unmoved mover? Yes and no, but mostly no. Yes, we do it despite the tendency to fall toward disorder. We work against the second law. But more importantly, we do it because of the second law, and that in two respects. If we weren't falling apart, we wouldn't need to keep putting ourselves back together. Self-healing is us dealing with or fitting our degenerative circumstances. But much more fundamentally, self-regeneration takes work, which takes energy. And what is energy? It's the second law. Energy is the tendency for order to become disordered. Energy is not a substance. It's a flow, a gradient, a tendency. Simple example. Put a frozen pizza in a hot box and the pizza heats up, right? Did you pump a substance called heat or energy into it? No, you remove the gap between the hot box and the frozen pizza. The air molecules in the oven were moving at all sorts of speeds, but on average, their speeds were faster than the molecules in that frozen pizza. With a little time, the speeds of both got disordered. At the macro scale, it seems that they equalized. But at the micro scale, molecule by molecule, there are randomized, faster and slower molecules everywhere throughout the pizza and oven combination. When you eat that pizza, you digest it, breaking it down further, using its energy flow to regenerate yourself. In other words, you use the second law of degeneration against itself. You put yourself in the path of an energy flow towards degeneration, and you focus or channel that energy flow into effort to regenerate your capacity to do that. To do what? To focus or channel energy into effort. It's circular. You're a self-regenerative channeling of energy. In channeling energy, you're wholly dependent on the second law, even as you're defying it. Wild, eh? You are a paradox. Okay, say the determinist, but what do you even mean? You're still just individual molecules in motion. Ultimately, I could boil you down to one-on-one molecule-on-molecule material interactions. Ah, you materialists. You think material is all there is to nature. Don't you see the spaces between matter? Don't they count as nature too? Lesson one from the second law is that there is a difference between micro and macro. Materialists assume that predictable micro-motion is all there is. That's where determinists get their idea that willpower is just a figment. But at the macro scale, there's this irreversible tendency towards mixed-upness. By irreversible, here's what I mean. A video of two billiard balls bumping into each other looks the same backwards and forwards. It's reversible. But a video of a pool break is not. The transition from rack to broke looks natural. But the reverse transition from broke to rack does not. It looks unlikely, because it is unlikely. Unlikelinesses matter more than we tend to notice. If you want to understand what tends to happen, pay attention to what becomes unlikely to happen. If you want to understand willpower, pay attention to won't power. The don't go there self-control by which living beings prevent themselves from dying. Now, a minute ago I said you put yourself in a path of energy flow. For example, the pizza you run through your body, and you focus that flow of energy into work to regenerate yourself. You channel energy into effort to regenerate your ability to channel energy into effort. You're a channeler. Sounds new age, right? I don't mean it that way, as I'll show you. But first, please notice that you being a channeler is damned intuitive. Think about it. Your willpower isn't just the energy you got from that pizza. I mean, you could use that pizza's energy flow to do anything. For example, to start a fire that burns down your house. But instead, you controlled it. You channeled it into your priority effort today. And what is your priority? Getting to live another day. Today, you channel energy into effort that enables you to continue to channel energy tomorrow. You'll do that till you die. I'm a channel that limits the work that energy could do. My willpower is my ability to prevent energy from doing just any work, to prevent myself from dithering. I'm not something added to physics. I'm a limitation on what is physically possible. And so is a machine. Engineers are in the flow prevention business. Energy flows could do whatever, but engineers wrangle, corral, focus, and channel energy flows into the work we living beings want. We living beings are like that, but different for two reasons that get overlooked lots, even by scientists. First, we're not engineered. Our willpower wasn't willed by some engineer. Our willed, purposeful behavior emerged by accident at the origins of life. But most importantly, a machine does work that benefits us, not the machine. A machine doesn't regenerate itself the way we do. It's made of durable parts pitted against each other to channel energy. We are not. We have to keep regenerating our own parts. For example, those 330 billion cells you make today. In fact, the 4.5 million cells you've made since you started watching this video. Cells that enable you to regenerate more cells tomorrow and beyond. Okay, but if you're not an engineered machine, where the hell did we get this capacity to channel or focus energy flows? Remember, I don't get to insert any imaginable gizmos. I don't get to just say we focus or channel energy. I have to explain how an ability to channel energy could ever emerge within nothing but energy flowing towards disorder. The answer is energies, flows, flowing against each other. Flows are local. Two local flows can cross and counter one another. Imagine crossing a stream. You're flowing one way, the water's flowing another way. Feel the pressure throwing you off course? The same is true for flows that aren't trying to do anything. What's water turbulence? It's energy flows working against each other. With turbulence, sometimes you get a whole new energy flow, a spiral whirlpool, an eddy, turbulence falling into a flow of less resistance. Now, a whirlpool ain't alive. It makes no effort and has no willpower. Still, it exposes what's been hiding in our philosophical and scientific blind spot. Newsflash, even though everything flows toward disorder, order can emerge when flows work against each other. You could call it synergy, which literally means working together, and is often defined as the whole is more than the sum of its parts, whatever the hell that means. The newsflash is that synergy is flows working against each other, as with turbulence, making some flows relatively less likely, leaving other flows relatively more likely. The whole is not more than the sum of its parts. Rather, the whole is the way that turbulence can resolve into new paths of less resistance around paths of more resistance. The whirlpool's whole spiral flow is the unlikelification of more turbulent paths. You can think of it a bit like a traffic jam. A traffic jam is not a solid, durable thing. It's congestion. It's cars passing through. But when it's present, when that congestion happens, when the spaces between the cars get tight enough, then it becomes a path of more resistance, and cars take detours around it. Because the congestion is a path of more resistance. Congestion is a fluid prevention, an unlikelification, and unlikely to go there. Actually, emergence happens. It happens not as added somethings, but subtracted possibilities. Flows that once were likely becoming unlikely when flows are working against each other. It's not magic. Why does this matter? Why is it worth wrapping your head around it? Because for millennia, we've been racking our brains thinking, wait, you can't get blood from a stone. You can't get new phenomena from the same old material and the micro interactions among those material objects, those atoms or molecules. So the only way to explain will would be if there's some added gizmo like a soul or spirit or some scientifically named internal prime mover, will or motivation, that could decide what to have for dinner completely independent of outside influences. Now, Whirlpool's emergent order isn't trying to keep itself going. Its orderly spiral flow is maintained wholly by circumstances. As such, it's as passive as determinists claim we are. Whirlpools aren't the only kind of emergent order. Though it's harder to see why, chain reactions and crystal formations are also like that. Also, passive orderly forms maintained solely by circumstances. Now, if you couple two of these emergent order-generating processes, you get something a smidge more proactive. Deacon suggests that willpower starts with a chain reaction that doesn't just grow, but grows crystal shells in its own midst. It's like turbulence, but up a notch. So these two processes, a chain reaction and something that captures, these little shells that capture and preserve some of the chain reaction molecules, could serve as seeds that, when broken open, will regenerate the chain reaction. What you get is two emergent order-generating processes that keep each other from ending. It's more than I can describe in this video. Here's a Google talk where I explain it a bit better. In a nutshell, crystal shells capture enough of the chain reaction molecules that if a shell breaks open, there's a chance that the chain reaction will resume. That'd be the origins of our fundamental self-healing nature and thus of willpower. It's like a toehold on a leg up on the uphill struggle against the second law. And it's a bit like a ratchet. From there, life can evolve. If you've made it this far, geez, thank you for deliberating with me. Deliberating, unfreeing yourself, imposing some self-control to stick with this through whatever channel-changing temptation and turbulent ambivalence you might have had, given all the other things you could have done while generating those 4.5 million new cells. I'll end by noticing that free is a contronym, a word that means two opposite things. A word like dust, which means to remove dust as in dusting, or apply dust as in dusting a donut. Free means your freedom to exert your will with great self-discipline. With great deliberation, as you unfree yourself to exert your will, you constrain yourself, your channel. Freedom in that sense would be like perfect freedom to do exactly what you want and in perfect safety. You'd be free to exert your will in a completely safe environment. But free also means the opposite of deliberation, a mind free from self-control. Like a schizophrenic bouncing around safe within a padded self. Or like the pizza molecules from my last meal ever that once I die will no longer be trying to do anything, just bouncing around every which way. On that cheerful note, See you next time. And I promise not to be so, so much. Next time. I'll be back to Earth, I promise.
Well, it turns out few people in the world are into as much raw introspection about the human condition as I am. And if you're one of them, please like, comment, subscribe, and share. And that's another thing. I'm for hire. I do strategic consulting on dealing with life's tough judgment calls and dealing with total jerks. My email's down below. Get in touch for a free sample session. Thanks.